not here.
Okay, so let me first things first, let me make this episode some time before I'm not only pretty informed. I won't talk to you, but I'll talk with you. So that said, let me pick up the thread from where Amit left it, which is two threads actually, which is history as in India has been distorted. Indian history has been distorted. And I mean, let's not get into the reasons why it has been so, because I'm sure pretty much everybody in this room are familiar with it. I don't have to really elaborate on that. And my goal, or rather the purpose of this exposition, is to bring in not just an alternate perspective, as Amit said, but to examine different ways in which Indian history has been written, has been looked at by different people, by different historians, including Indian historians themselves, and see, you know, hopefully throw some light on what's been happening, and maybe how we can explore ways to correct it. So that said, we will quickly first look at some academics and dry bone definitions. So let's look at how history itself is defined. I'll read out from this one. So basically, it's defined as a study of the human past. Yet another definition is, it's a field of research which uses a narrative to examine and analyze a sequence of events and attempts to investigate objectively the patterns of cause and effect that determine events. And from this, you can also, you know, kind of evolve some characteristics of history, which is that it is said that history is also a set of stories that are common to particular cultures but not supported by external sources. And these, while they're strictly not called history, they can be classified usually as cultural heritage rather than the disinterested investigation needed by the discipline of history. Because if you look at how history as an academic discipline has evolved, it means that it basically says, don't accept anything without evidence. And don't, even if you have evidence, one evidence is not enough, you need several corroborations of that evidence. Until you can pinpoint and say, okay, this is how it has happened, you know, this is what this means. So that usually is how the history methodology is. And events prior to written record are considered as prehistory, that is the oral tradition of history is not considered, it doesn't fall in the ambit of history, it's called prehistory. Okay. Now these are important as we shall see and as we go on. And now based on these we can arrive at some conclusions. Like I said, the events written to prior to the written record is known as prehistory, which logically means that the advent of writing plays a major role in our definition of history. Right? So when was writing formally, you know, it came into, was systematized in any culture, any civilization. So if you had a period of say 100 years, 300 years, 1000 years where humans hadn't invented the system of writing, it is considered, strictly considered, not as history. But does that mean we need to discard all such prehistory? We need to examine that. And then the oral tradition, like I said, however authentic it is and however well preserved it is kept beyond the definition of history. And all oral tradition occurring even after the advent of writing aren't considered as historical evidence. And now the final point in this conclusion is an interesting one. Now, historians typically debate the nature of history and its usefulness, like why do we need to study history? And historiographers, they study history as a discipline in itself, as an end in itself. What that means is, it includes discussing the study of history as a discipline, as an end in itself, and as a way of providing the perspective to solve the problem of the present based on what we learn from the study of history. Now this last one is extremely significant for the purpose of this discussion. Now that said, you have different conceptions of history. what is the Indian conception of history? The word for history in India traditionally is a Sanskrit word called, which is what is said in the region language. That's a term for region language. It's called itihasa. Now the Sanskrit word itihasa can be split into three parts. It means iti plus ha plus asa, which simply means that it happened thus, meaning you are telling the truth. Like the best example I can give is, you know, somebody reporting this charcha. It happened thus. Sandeep spoke this way. I mean, interviews. Okay, participants asked some questions and then you all had tea and then tea. So somebody reporting that faithfully, it happened thus. That is itihasa. Now, as far as India is concerned, only two epics are only epics according to itihasa. Ramayana. Traditionally, they are called itihasa. As opposed to, or rather, as different from your Puranas or the Vedas. Now, this is a significant difference because we will see that. Now, if you look at the Western conception of history, it is just a chronicle of events. This happened this year, wars broke out this year, a famine occurred this year, somebody died this year, a new king usurped the throne, somebody was born. So it's just a linear chronicle of events. Now, if you look at the conception of history by different, am I going too fast?
No, you're good.
So if you look at how history itself is conceived by different civilizations, whether East or West, you notice that that conception has its rooted, or its basis is in how they conceive time. Now, in the Western conception of time, it is linear, time is linear, like it keeps going straight. But if you look at the Indian conception of time, it is cyclic. Now, the best instance to say this Indian conception of time is cyclic is our concept of yugas. Now, you say it is a cycle of time. You have this one, you know, golden age where everything is fine. As everything is fine, that's called the Pratyuga, and then the dissolution, end of the time, Kaliyuga, when it ends, this destruction evil everywhere. And it doesn't stop at that. Once it dissolves, there's a rebirth again. So the cycle of time continues. So the moment I use the word cycle of time, it means our conception of time is cyclic. Right? So this also impacts how we view things. Another way of saying this thing is how we look at good and evil. How have Indians traditionally treated good and evil? Now, if you look at the Western philosophy, there is an entire subject devoted to what is called the problem of evil. Perhaps no other culture or civilization has analyzed evil in so many different ways as the West has done. But how do we view good and evil? In India, we don't have the concept of a problem of evil because we consider good and evil as two sides of the same coin. So this side, you have good, you toss it over, you have evil. Now one, okay, the very near example for this, again you can find it in our epics, Puranas basically, is the story of Hiranyakashipu and his son Prahlada. Now both of them did the same thing. Both of them were obsessed with Vishnu in a different way. Right? So the end result, what happened, both of them, I mean, this guy was killed. Hiranyakashipu was killed. And even throughout his life, he kept meditating upon him in a different way. And his own son who caused his death, and so to say, also meditated on Vishnu in a different way. So this is how we have solved the problem of, the so-called problem of evil. All this has an impact of how we have viewed history and how others have viewed our history. We'll come to that. And in a way, I mean, personally speaking, if you want to define the history of India or talk about the history of India, I would say that it is the biography of a few great men and women. Now, one question I have is, which of the school textbooks and other history writing in India so far reflects these features. None of them, as far as I am aware, as far as my reading goes, none of them have been trying to approach our history from this perspective. Or putting the same question in differently, what is the perspective from which the history of India as we read today is written? The answer, as far as I can see, is the Marxist perspective, all that, I mean, we're all familiar with it. It's not a perspective as such, it's ideology. That apart, the perspective of Indian history writing since at least the last three centuries has been the Eurocentric perspective. Eurocentric is one which keeps Europe as a center and looks at the history and cultures of other civilizations in the world. Now, how and why this happened is what we will explore.